Before we begin our liturgy, you are kindly requested to turn off all electronic devices, including cell phones. As a family, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph faced an uncertain world with faith. We gather together on this Feast of the Holy Family to celebrate their steadfast courage and commitment. This liturgy is being offered for the deceased members of the Pecchia family, and also for the people of the parish. We begin our prayer by standing and joining in singing number 424, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, number 424.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Merry Christmas. I say that to remind us that we live in a season of Christmas. Sometimes we just have that one day and it's all done. But this is a time of joy and a time to let those truths of the incarnation of God with us really sink deeply in. And this Sunday we celebrate a special way, the Feast of the Holy Family. So we ask God's blessing upon all of our families and to continue to help us to strive to keep Jesus as the center of our lives. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we prepare to celebrate the sacred mysteries, we call to mind our own sins and we ask the Lord's mercy and forgiveness. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Let us pray. O God, who were pleased to give us the shining example of the Holy Family, graciously grant that we may imitate them in practicing the virtues of family life and in the bonds of charity. And so, in the joy of your house, delight one day in eternal rewards. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. The readings can be found at number 1007, number 1007.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. I will make your reward very great." But Abram said, "O Lord God, what good will your gift be if I keep on being childless and have as my heir the steward of my house, Eliezer?" Abram continued, "See, you have given me no offspring, and so one of my servants will be my heir." Then the word of the Lord came to him, "No, that one shall not be your heir. Your own issue shall be your heir." The Lord took Abram outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars if you can." "Just so," he added, "shall your descendants be." Abram put his faith in the Lord, who credited it to him as an act of righteousness. The Lord took note of Sarah, as he had said he would, and he did for her as he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore Abram a son in his old age. Abram gave the name Isaac to his son of his, who Sarah bore him. The word of the Lord.
The antiphon to the psalm can be found at number 86. Blessed are those who love you. Happy those who follow you. Blessed are those who seek you, O God.
Blessed are those who love you. Happy those who follow you. Blessed are those who seek you, O God.
Happy all those who fear the Lord and walk in God's pathway. You will find what you long for, the riches of our God.
Bless our Lord.
Your spouse shall be like a fruitful vine in the midst of your home. Your children flourish like olive plants, rejoicing at your table.
Bless our Lord.
Blessings of God be yours all the days of your life. May the peace and the love of God live always in your heart.
Bless our Lord, who love you.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. He went out not knowing where he was to go. By faith he received power to generate, even though he was past the normal age. And Sarah herself was sterile, for he thought that the one who had made the promise was trustworthy. So it was that there came forth from one man, himself as good as dead, descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and as countless as the sands on the seashore. By faith, Abraham, when he put to the test, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises was ready to offer his only son, of whom it was said, through Isaac, descendants shall bear your name. He reasoned that God was able to raise even from the dead, and he received Isaac back as a symbol. The word of the Lord.
Christ control your hearts. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly.
The Lord be with you.
And
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. When the days were completed for their purification according to the law of Moses, the parents of Jesus took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, just as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every male that opens the womb shall be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer the sacrifice of a pair of turtle doves and or two young pigeons, in accordance with the dictate in the law of the Lord. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, awaiting the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Christ of the Lord. He came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, "Now, Master, you may let your servant go in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you prepared in sight of all the peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and glory for your people Israel." The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him, and Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted. And you yourself a sword shall pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed." There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived 7 years with her husband after her marriage, and then as a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day with fasting and prayer. And coming forward at that very time, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were awaiting the redemption of Israel. When they had fulfilled all the prescriptions of the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord. Well, today we celebrate the Feast of the Holy Family, and so we think of Mary and Joseph and the baby Jesus. And I heard someone once say to me, like, Father, how could we be like the family, the Holy Family? Jesus, you know, if any kid was like Jesus, there'd be no problems, right? And their mother was Mary, infinite patience, and Joseph, you know. And so what can happen sometimes, I think, when we think of the Holy Family, we can sometimes idealize them and maybe dismiss the realities of family life. I just had the privilege of being with my brother's family this past week. I left on Christmas evening and stayed, and I just got back yesterday, and they have 6 kids, aging from 7 to, I don't know, 16 now. Let me just say it this way. Family life is not easy, all right? I don't want to get into any of the details, but you can watch how a sister can pinch a brother when she's accused of something. Or, you know, I watched my one little nephew hit the other brother, and I thought I was watching a soccer game when there was, like, that fake penalty. Did you ever see that, where, like, a soccer player gets hit and, like, I'm like, it's crazy, the reaction to that, you know? Or, you know, one of the jobs was to be is to put the dishes in the dishwasher away. But you know what you have to do? You have to make sure the dishes were washed. Yeah, exactly. So what's going on in a family? Well, I like to say it this way. A family is a school of love. Now, what do you do in school? You learn. You get educated, right? There's a lot of trial and error. There's a lot of practice. You know, you work through different situations so that you can acquire some experience and knowledge. And so in God's plan, he looks at the family as the environment in which we learn how to love. Now, when we say the word love in our modern day, oh, love, you know, we can kind of over-idealize this idea of love. But when we talk about love in the Gospels, we look to Jesus. He says this, there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. And so the authentic meaning of love often is sacrificial love, learning to overcome our selfishness and to learn to become more and more Christ-like and become selfless, right? And so the family, according to God's plan, is the environment in which we learn and we learn and we learn. I mean, if we're honest and we really reflect on it, I think sometimes we have this misnomer that everything's going to go smooth sailing and be perfect. And it doesn't happen that way. We sometimes say things we regret. We sometimes do things we know we shouldn't have done. Sometimes we tell little lies to get out of trouble with our brothers and sisters. You know, I'm not in any way trying to throw my brother's family under the bus, but I hear a lot of family. I mean, this is the challenge that we have. And so what makes a holy family the holy family, I like to say, is that Jesus is the center, right? The family, holy family, is holy because Jesus is at the center. And so I think for all of us, we strive to make Jesus the center of our lives. Jesus becomes our model. Jesus becomes the one who we learn from. And everyone, as a Christian, we're called to imitate Jesus. We're called to become more and more like Christ in the way we live our lives. And that's the standard. And so you have parents who are still, you know, I always like to joke around, when a baby's born, the manual doesn't pop out with a baby, right? So you see a young couple and a young mom, she's kind of overwhelmed, right? What is this am I supposed to do? How is this all going to work? Do you know? And perhaps you have our own experience where we grew up in a family and maybe we have some serious issues with our parents or a lot of challenges. You know, this is not an easy, it's difficult, it's painful at times. And so what we do is we look to the Holy Family to give us, I guess you could say, an example, guidance, prayers, and to help us grow in these virtues. And I don't know if you follow along. There's a lot of different options in the readings for Holy Family. And, you know, this idea that we are to, I came across this other line that I was reflecting on, that we are to bear with one another, forgiving one another. If one has a grievance against another, as the Lord has forgiven you, so must you also do. So I think the key to family life is a lot of forgiveness, a lot of humility to say, look, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say what I said to you. I didn't mean to react that way. And we have to constantly practice that virtue. You know, I came across this little excerpt from St. Francis de Sales, and he talks about this. He says, you know, sometimes I'm paraphrasing this, we can over-idealize the Holy Family. But he said this: think of the difficulties and changes, joys and sorrows found in the Holy Family. Mary received news that she would conceive by the Holy Spirit a son, our Lord and Savior. What joy this was for her. Shortly afterward, Joseph, seeing that she was with child and knowing that it was not by him, was plunged into distress. Mary was in grief, seeing her dear Joseph was about to leave her. When this storm passed, they experienced great joy. There was also joy in their hearts when the shepherds and the magi came. And then we go a little bit further, and we hear today's gospel, the presentation of the child Jesus. So we see that Mary and Joseph were faithful Jews who followed the law of Moses to redeem the firstborn child and to offer the necessary ritual offerings in the temple. And we see that they are a poor family because the offering for poor families were the two pigeons. And so we see that they had a simple, humble family. But then this old man and this old woman come up to him and they start prophesying about this child. And Simeon gives this prophecy to Mary that, you know, a sword will pierce your heart. And she must have been like, what? A little later, Joseph in a dream, remember, take the child and his mother and flee into Egypt. Without doubt, Mary and Joseph were troubled by this command. This is St. Francis de Sales writing. What was Joseph's response? Why do I have to go at night? Couldn't this journey wait till the morning? I have neither horse nor money. If we had been in Joseph's place, would we not have made 1,000 excuses? Whereas he promptly did all that the angel commanded, the peace and serenity of mind of Mary and Joseph shows their constant openness to God's will amid all the unexpected events that befell them. So I think if we really, really look at it in a deep way, we can, from what we see, we can even go a little bit further in the gospel, because we don't have a lot about the early life of Jesus, but you can imagine Mary and Joseph when they lost their child in the temple, and it took them 3 days to find them. Think of these experiences in your own life, in your own families. There's moments of joy, and there's moments of woe, there's moments of fear, there's moments of anxieties. We're not sure how certain things will unfold or outcome. And so St. Francis de Sales says this: we too, when we meet similar problems in our lives, must repeat over and over again to ourselves so as to better to impress the truth on our minds that no disturbance of events must ever carry away our hearts and minds into unevenness of temper, or what he means by that, to rob us of peace. Actually, every time we come to Mass, it's kind of like a reset, right? We have to remind ourselves that we are celebrating in this Christmas season, but throughout our lives, God is with us. The God of the universe is with you. And what happens is we get overwhelmed by the circumstances of life. We can forget that. We put Jesus on the shelf. We've got to figure it out all ourselves. And it just leads to more and more anxiety. Jesus wants to accompany us. And so what we're called to do is we're called to invite Jesus into our relationships, our struggles, our difficulties. Jesus doesn't love us when we get everything together and everything right. Then he loves us. Jesus wants to love us right where we're at so that he can help us grow in those virtues. Lastly, I just want to share one other thing too. I have it here. I came across this quote by Pope Francis on the reflection of Simeon and Anna. He said, Simeon took him in his arms and thanked God that he had finally seen salvation Anna, despite her advanced age, found new vigor and began to speak to everyone about the baby. It's a beautiful image. Two young parents and two elderly people brought together by Jesus. Jesus is the one who brings together and unites generations. Jesus is the inexhaustible font of that love which overcomes every occasion of self-absorption, solitude, and sadness. Jesus has to be the foundation of all of our relationships. That makes me think of our purpose. Why do we exist as a parish, you know? Our Lady Mercy and St. Anthony exist to create a community where people experience healing and joy that comes from a loving relationship with Jesus Christ. And so during this Christmas season, what happens is we are presented with God coming into this world as a baby, as an invitation to be held, as an invitation to grow in a friendship, in a relationship with him. This is Pope Francis, and I'll close with these words. In your journey as a family, you share so many beautiful moments, meals, rest, housework, leisure, prayer, vacations, times of mutual support. Nevertheless, if there is no love, then there is no joy. And authentic love comes to us from Jesus. Jesus offers us his word, which illuminates our path. And he gives us the bread of life, which sustains us on our journey. Today, as we enter into this feast, as we begin this new week in this Christmas season, Christmas is made present on this altar in a mysterious way. The same Jesus that we see an image in our manger scene is made present under the form of bread and wine in the Holy Eucharist. Jesus wants to be close to us. He wants to come into our manger, our hearts, our lives. And we want to welcome him. And we want to grow in our friendship and relationship with him, because ultimately, Jesus is the source of authentic joy and authentic love. And when we have Jesus alive in us, then that can begin to permeate our minds, our hearts, our lives, and then that is exhibited through our interactions. And so that we can bring love and joy into the world if we allow him to live deeply within us. And that can affect our natural families, our family as a parish, the family of the church, and ultimately our universal family as members of the world. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and his kingdom will have no end. Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic Church. I confess all baptism with the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead. God humbled himself to be born of a human family and sanctified family life forever. Our response to the petition is, Lord, be born in us.
That the many ministries of the church may strengthen family life throughout the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, be with us.
For all couples, that they may grow in their love for each other and be signs of God's unconditional love to each other, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all parents, that they may love their children and be faithful witnesses of virtue and integrity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us.
For all parents, particularly those who struggle with their children, that they may be guided by Christ toward new ways of leading their children to responsibility and maturity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us.
For all children, that they may grow safely in body, mind, and spirit, and develop their gifts and talents to the fullest. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us.
That families burdened by divorce, abuse, or alienation may seek and find the help of the Holy Family. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us.
That our family members who are ill may enjoy the consolation of the Lord and the presence of their loved ones. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us.
For all who have died, especially deceased members of the Pecchia family, and our recently deceased, Monsignor John P. Murphy and Reverend William N. Seifert, that they may be welcomed into eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, be born in us. Father, we thank you for the gift of life and family. Answer all our prayers and bring all people into your family of grace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
As we offer our gifts to the Father, we join in singing number 457, Sing of Mary, Pure and Lowly. Number 457.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We offer you, Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation, humbly ask that through the intercession of the Virgin Mother of God and Saint Joseph, you may establish our families firmly in your grace and your peace. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, a new light of your glory has shone upon the eyes of our mind, so that as we recognize in him God made visible, we may be caught up through him in love of things invisible. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather people to yourself so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection, descension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Anthony, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope Alfred, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church," graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
As we come forward to receive Jesus, we join in singing number 940, You Satisfy the Hungry Heart, number 940.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Bring those you refresh with this heavenly sacrament, most merciful Father, to imitate constantly the example of the Holy Family, so that after the trials of this world, we may share their company forever. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
January 1st is the solemnity of Mother Mary, Mother of God. The Mass will be held on Monday morning at 8 a.m. at Our Lady of Mercy. This will be the only Mass for the Holy Day. Renewed in faith, we go forth singing number 428, Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Let me just clarify that. This year, the Holy Day is not obligatory. That's why there's only one Mass, okay? So usually it's the obligation for the Holy Day, and there's multiple Masses, just to be clear on that. If you wish to go on Sunday night, I believe St. James does have an evening Mass. Thank you.
Number 428, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Number 428.